Good evening, everyone. It is a great pleasure and an honor to be here today. Of course, no one, I guess, could be mistaken into thinking that you were me because you lack a very strong Italian accent that instead I do have. So I don't know whether I need to use the microphone or whether perhaps you can hear me also without. Also without, let's try. And if it is too low, just let me know. Okay. So what I would like to do in the time at our disposal is to focus not really on what is going on at the moment in the copyright policy debate, because I guess that you know about the intricacies of the policy debate much more and better than me. What instead I would like to focus on is on existing law, something in particular that was adopted a while ago, that is the InfoSoc Directive of 2001, and see how and whether, more than how, whether any lessons can be learned about the process of copyright harmonization from what is, I guess, rightly to be considered the most important piece of harmonization adopted so far. And in particular, I would like to focus on a provision in the InfoSoc Directive, which is Article 5, and that contains the regulation of possible exceptions to be adopted under the directive. So I would like to ask you whether you are familiar with Article 5. So basically, the InfoSoc Directive is one of the few directives that have been adopted at the European level. It is the most important because, unlike other pieces of legislation, it carried out an horizontal harmonization without specific regard to any particular type of work, as it had been instead the case for reasons of computer programs and databases. So in this sense, there is this horizontal harmonization of some of the exclusive rights granted by copyright, this being reproduction, communication to the public, and distribution. And this means that member states had to approach the scope of copyright protection in an harmonized fashion. In parallel to this, the directive also introduced a list of exceptions that could be adopted at the national level, exceptions to the rights harmonized in that piece of legislation. Article 5, as I will say a bit more at length in a few moments, has been subject to extensive discussion and I would say also extensive criticism for being an optional list, for being an exhaustive list that makes it impossible to adapt to technological advancement, and also for being extremely formalistic and with the result that copyright in Europe will be less flexible than what is the case elsewhere. And in this sense, focusing on Article 5, something has been proposed for years as the correct reading of this provision, and it is the fact that it will be inherently flexible. What would that mean? That you, as a member state, can pick the exceptions from the list, decide which you want to implement, and when you decide to transpose them, you would enjoy quite significant freedom in defining the scope of national exceptions derived from EU law. This, as a matter of fact, is what has happened. And the result has been that, for instance, the way we intend quotation in France is different from the way in which quotation is meant in England. It is different from Germany, it is different from Italy. So all in all, yes, all these national exceptions derived from EU law, but as a matter of fact, very different in their resulting scope. And here I would like to provide a couple of examples. One is quotation, which I've already mentioned, and the other one is freedom of panorama, which, especially at the policy debate, has resurfaced in the context of the report on the InfoSoc Directive prepared by Julia Reda. So this idea that there is a flexibility under EU copyright law, I think, is a bit of a fairy tale, something that we believe in, but it might not be the correct reading of reality. And in this sense, the ugly truth is what has happened at the level of case law, in particular at the level of Court of Justice of the European Union, which over time has substantially told member states that the freedom they thought they had is no longer or is not really there. So from this evolution, I think that we can have some points of reflection for the current debate around the DSM directive and what will be quite a novel approach to exceptions, because this directive would create mandatory exceptions that leave no room for optional decisions at the level of individual member states. So let's take a look a bit more in detail at existing legislation and in particular Article 5 of the InfoSoc Directive. This is a list of 21 exceptions, which are all optional for member states to adopt, with the exclusion of temporary copies. Temporary copies is the only exception that everyone is required to adopt, but for the rest, you can pick and choose the exception that you want. It is also a list that is exhaustive, and this means that you cannot go beyond the catalog provided by the text of the directive, and all exceptions and limitations are subject to the three-step test, meaning that they should be limited to certain special cases which do not conflict with the normal exploitation of a work and do not unreasonably prejudice the legitimate interest of right holders. This is something that has been derived from international law and is something that is present also in the directive. As I said, these exceptions have been considered by leading commentators as categorically worded prototypes, some guidelines as to what quotation might be, but in the end you can do as you please. And in fact, this is what has happened at the level of individual member states. Let's take a couple of examples to see indeed what the practice has been. Quotation is one of them. You find that in Article 5, paragraph 3, letter D of the InfoSoc Directive. And if you read the text of the provision, I guess that most of you might not be lawyers, but if we look at the requirements, basically it says that member states can introduce this exception for quotation for purposes such as criticism or review. So here, the first point is, yes, criticism or review might be one of the reasons for the quotation, but perhaps it is not the only one. Second point, the quotation must be of a work that has been made lawfully available. So for instance, it is a work that must have been published. And then it is required to provide acknowledgement of the source, and the quotation must be in compliance with fair practice, meaning that you have to keep the quote to the minimum indispensable to make your point without, for instance, reproducing the entirety of a work if that is not required by the objective that you are trying to achieve. So I would say that reading the text of the directive, you get some guidelines, but apart from that, it is debatable whether member states can introduce additional requirements for the quotation. This instead is what has happened at the level of national practices. I shall provide you with a couple of examples, Italy and France, which in this sense are quite similar. First of all, both countries say that quotations can be for specific purposes only. So they must be only for criticism, discussion, or education, but nothing else. In this sense, the approach is different, for instance, from the case of the United Kingdom, which introduced a quotation exception for any purposes. Italy then has another peculiarity that if you are engaging in the online dissemination of images, as it might be the case of memes and GIFs, which might be quotes from other works, then this dissemination must be at a low resolution, it must be non-commercial, and it must be only for educational scientific uses. Is that the case of memes? We can open a discussion about that. And then finally, France has a requirement that a quotation must be incorporated in a work. So this means that the quotation cannot be self-standing. And again, if we think of the case of memes and GIFs, there is no work to which they are attached. So again, under French law, this question would arise. And if we look at the Italian and French cases, here I have provided a GIF on the left-hand side and a meme on the right-hand side, taken from Disney's film Beauty and the Beast. First of all, when we create a GIF and a meme, the question that one might think about is, am I reproducing something that is protected by copyright? And the answer might be potentially yes. So potentially there might be also an infringement of someone else's copyright in the making of a GIF and a meme, because it doesn't matter that you copy a lot or little. What is required is that what has been copied is sufficiently original and therefore protected by copyright. In this sense, it is not a quantitative assessment, it is a qualitative one. And of course, when it comes to GIFs and memes, what you are reproducing is images that have some sort of value in themselves. They might be iconic moments of a film, they might be photographs that people are quite used to see. And so in this sense, and if I add to borrow from the language of trademark law, they are distinctive. They might be also protected by copyright. And these might present the risk of infringing someone else's rights. Then you can think, perhaps I can invoke the quotation exception for a GIF or a meme. But again, if we looked at French law, a meme or a GIF is a self-standing quotation, so the French exception will not apply. The Italian law requires the dissemination to be for scientific, educational purposes, and again, a GIF and a meme is something to have a laugh, but it is not a scientific or educational by its very nature. And this might mean that under current laws, the making of a GIF or a meme might not be completely risk-free. So this leads me to the current days in which we are reading that Article 13 of the DSM Directive, if adopted, might make it impossible to share GIFs and memes online. This will be the end of the internet as we know it, because of potential filtering systems that will not be able to detect what can be shared without a license and what instead requires a license. While this concern is well placed and relates to the limits of technology, it overlooks to consider that also under existing laws, it's not that we have a super liberal system in which also these images can be shared without any problems. No one has ever been sued over a GIF or a meme yet, but if this person was, then current legislation might not be as friendly as sometimes we think it is. Let's move to another case, freedom of panorama. I guess that you might be familiar what it is. It is basically the possibility, again, optional, to make reproductions of works to be displayed on a permanent basis in public locations. The origin of freedom of panorama is again found in Article 5 of the InfoSoc Directive, which allows member states to provide for an exception to some of the economic rights to allow the use of works, such as works of architecture or sculpture, made to be located permanently in public places. Again, if a lawyer reads this provision, you get a couple of information. First one is that the exception relates to an indefinite number of works, indefinite types of works, not just works of architecture or sculpture. That the use of such as means that it is an example, not it is that's it and no more than that. The other condition, which instead is a bit more stringent, is that these works must be made to be located permanently in public places. So that is a condition that EU law sets. Then, if we look at how member states have transposed the freedom of panorama, the panorama that we get is fairly fragmented. First of all, different laws provided exception applies to different types of works. So we have that in France, it is only for works of architecture and sculptures. In the UK, it is buildings, sculptures, models for buildings, works of artistic craftsmanship. In Sweden, it is only works of fine art. In Denmark, it is only for buildings. And in Germany, there are no limitations as to the types of works that can be eligible for the application of the exception. But again, you have the idea of an harmonization that has not really had the effects that it was believed it would achieve. And then the second limitation that has arisen at the level of some member states is that some countries have decided to limit the availability of the exception to non-commercial uses of these works. That is, for instance, the case of France. Instead, Denmark does not pose any limitations as regards the type of use, but it poses limitations as regards the type of reproduction that can be only in pictorial form. If you ask, what does that all mean in practice? I can provide you with my own personal experience. I've been recently victim of the French Freedom of Panorama exception, which was introduced quite recently. So I've recently finished a book on the case law of the Court of Justice in the area of copyright. And as a cover, very banally, I would like to use a picture of the main courtroom in Luxembourg. And I found this picture on the website of the CJU, and the licensing terms is that this photograph is free to use as long as the name of the photographer is mentioned. So fair enough, I send it to the publisher and they said, let's use this one because I like it and it is descriptive of the book. A few weeks later, I receive an email from the publisher in which I am informed that yes, the photograph might be free to use, but what is represented in it is not. Why? Because the architect of the courtroom is a member of one of the collecting societies in France, and under French law, we are required to clear the rights with him to use this photograph. So I've been sent a quote, and now I have to pay this fee if I want to use this photograph, because indeed the book will be a commercial use of the image and therefore of the work embodied in it, and we need to clear the rights also with the architect. So this is an example of a fairly strict national exception that shows the oddities of copyright law in which the photographer would not be able to assert their rights, but the architect, because of what is represented in the picture, will be. So all this leads to a panorama of national exceptions, which is very fragmented. And the question that arises is whether this approach is correct from a legal standpoint, or whether instead something went wrong at the implementation phase. And indeed, this leads to the ugly truth, and it is the fact that these categorically worded prototypes that were believed to be European copyright exceptions are not really prototypes, and many member states made mistakes when they implemented these exceptions, adding conditions, requirements that at the EU level are not really present. And in this sense, we have quite a few decisions from the Court of Justice sending this message consistently. And in particular, that has been the case of private copying. If you have ever worked in this area, you will know that private copying is incredibly messy. There are very inconsistent approaches at the level of member states, and speaking of a European approach to private copying is impossible. And the Court of Justice in this case law has said consistently that member states cannot engage in inconsistent transpositions of the directive. Once they decide to transpose an exception from EU law into their national laws, they have to comply with the scope that has been harmonized at the EU level. So adding requirements, conditions, something that is even against the wording of the directive would expose them to potential liability for infringing their obligations under EU law. And for instance, this has been the case of the Dutch private copying exception. In Dutch law, it was possible to download content unlawfully from the internet, peer-to-peer file sharing, and then say it's fine because it is private copying. That is indeed what Dutch law said. There was litigation brought by collecting societies in the Netherlands, and eventually the case was referred to the Court of Justice that said, no, you cannot have these inconsistent approaches to private copying, you have to comply with the three-step test, and your freedom does not go beyond the text of EU provisions. And the same has happened in relation to the funding of fair compensation for private copying, the amount of this fair compensation, who has to pay it, and then also the beneficiaries. And the topic of the beneficiaries is also relevant to the ongoing DSM directive debate. Why is that? Because in a case that was referred from Belgium, Reprobel, the Court of Justice substantially said that Belgium got private copying wrong when it said that publishers could be the beneficiaries of part of the fair compensation for private copying. The Court of Justice said, no, that is wrong, because publishers are not reproduction right holders. They are not mentioned in the InfoSoc directive, and they cannot be given something that does not belong to them, also because the rationale of private copying compensation is harm caused by the making of copies, and publishers will not suffer any harm. Now, this decision raised a lot of worries in the collecting society world and in the publishing world, and in the DSM directive there is a provision that, as far as I'm aware, has not been really discussed, which is Article 12, that is meant basically to delete this judgment from the Court of Justice, allowing again member states to say that if they want, yes, publishers can get part of the private copying compensation. And then a case that relates to quotation, that is the case that originated from Austria, Pioneer, said something that is quite upsetting to the French. And it is that you cannot set requirements for quotation other than those established at the EU level. So for instance, you cannot expect a quotation to be incorporated in a work. A quotation can be also self-standing. And that is against the approach taken in France. And in fact, some commentators following this decision said that, as a matter of fact, the Court of Justice might have invalidated the French approach to quotation. Is that true? Perhaps it does not go as far as that, because when we have directives, these do not have direct effects that can be relied upon by parties in national litigation. So it is not possible for a judge to disapply an incorrect national provision and apply instead directly the directive. This is not possible. And the Court of Justice clarified that in another case concerning collective rights management. However, the Advocate General in that case went beyond this formalistic reading of the directive, and said that if a judge is confronted with a national provision that goes against the text of a EU provision, then the judge should apply directly the directive. This is quite bold, and so far nothing has happened in this sense. So this is the scenario that we have now under existing legislation, which I think, as shown by the Court of Justice case law, is a bit different from what has been intended at the level of many commentators and practice of individual member states. And this leads me to the final point, and it is the ongoing debate around the DSM directive. As you all know, there are some provisions in this directive that set a new approach to copyright exceptions, because unlike the InfoSoc directive, they say that these exceptions should be mandatory for member states to have, no longer optional. However, I mean, things are a bit more complex than that, because yes, these exceptions might be mandatory. However, sometimes they might be intended as not as strong as one might think. Because for instance, if we take the exceptions for teaching, yes, that is mandatory, but at least in some formulations, it leaves room for licensing. So if there are good licensing solutions in place, the exception might not apply. The same for text and data mining. Again, here we have an exception that is mandatory, but at least in its original formulation, has also quite a narrow scope, in the sense that it would only apply to research organizations. And then again, over the debate that unfolded after that, there was the idea perhaps we can have also an optional exception for text and data mining that might be reserved also to subjects other than research organizations. So much for harmonization in this sense, because you tell me, yes, you have to have these mandatory exceptions, but if you want, you can also have something more. So again, you continue along this path that there is some harmonization at the EU level, but then what member states can do is really left to their own discretion. And then the final point is whether these new exceptions might be indeed useful. Let's take the case of text and data mining. Text and data mining is something that the Commission, in its impact assessment accompanying the directive, said is done by businesses, not research organizations. Nonetheless, despite this approach, the directive said that the exception should be only for those who are not doing text and data mining. So what is the point of having an exception of this kind? A, you want to stimulate research organizations to do text and data mining. That is, you know, the positive reading of it. B, you want to have an exception for people that are not really going to use it. So an exception that is not useful. But irrespective of how you look at it, the bottom line of this approach is that text and data mining is something that falls within the scope of copyright, and that is the real message that is sent. You have an exception that is a kind of cosmetic operation to say that if you are doing text and data mining without a license, then you might be at the risk of infringing someone else's rights. So again, this might not be a really helpful approach to designing copyright exceptions in the European Union. In conclusion, here we have a beast that is, if you wish, copyright. Its scope has expanded over time. We have exclusive rights that are increasingly broad, also because of the interpretation that has been given of them. The Court of Justice has repeated constantly that exclusive rights should be given a broad interpretation because copyright is deserving of a high level of protection. In parallel to that, we have had exceptions deriving from EU law that have been transposed inconsistently at the EU level, so that we do not really have an internal market for copyright protected works and related exceptions and limitations. Will things change with this new directive? Perhaps yes. At the end, also the beast managed to turn into a guy, but whether that is going to happen will depend on the final text of the directive, but also what will happen at the level of national transpositions, because an internal market where everyone is free to do as they please, perhaps is not a harmonized market for copyright protected content. And with that, I would like to conclude and thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take any comments, questions that you might have.